Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the opportunity to feel privileged and to be walking around the place where even the darkest of shadows reflect beautifully in the silver mirrors that Oscar Wilde told us about. I believe any place which can be remembered fondly by Oscar Wilde must be spectacularly enriching. Allow me to address you, even though you probably are here, because I happen to be, for a very short space of time, the failed finance minister of a bankrupt state. Allow me to address you initially on a topic that doesn't seem to have much to do with my endeavors, which are responsible for you being here. I want to begin by talking about academic freedom and about the experience of university life. After a year of being in politics, following a lifetime in the academy, I want to use this opportunity in order to draw connections between your experiences in this great university with the problems of the world, and in particular, the problems of a particularly problematic Europe. Given that in a short space of time, you're going to be making a momentous decision about this country's membership of the European Union, as people who have this opportunity to indulge in academic freedom, maybe this is not an impertinent topic for tonight. The economists that have shaped our ideas about the world we live in, great men, I'm afraid, there were no women amongst them, for reasons that Virginia Woolf has so beautifully explained in her masterpiece, A Room of One's Own. Those men, people like Jeremy Bentham, Adam Smith, David Ricardo, Karl Marx, John Stuart Mill, these men were free thinkers. I'm very much afraid that today's economists, who are shaping the debate in the Financial Times, in the Wall Street Journal, in the seats of power, do not experience the same degree of freedom. Let me explain this a little bit more. Tomorrow, from what I hear from your president, you were meant to have Noam Chomsky, and unfortunately, he couldn't make it. But Noam has made the important point about academia, that today it lacks the anti-establishment energy that it once had. Now, let's go back to these men. David Ricardo was a landowner who wrote extensively the most stinging critique of landowners. How come? What allowed him to turn against his own lot? Adam Smith incensed the whole establishment of the era by saying that the only way you can produce the good society is by empowering the selfish and those who don't care about the common good to be selfish in order to serve the common good despite the fact that they don't care about it. In Christian terms, this was a heresy at the time. The reason why these people, and I include in those John Stuart Mill, Karl Marx, and others, John Maynard Keynes, from the other place, as you might call it, they didn't give a damn about authority. They were independent scholars who did not have to worry about how to make a living and did not have to worry about serving the interests of a bureaucracy bent upon writing down and quantifying the performance of those scholars. Today, most academics, hopefully not in Oxford, it hasn't come here yet, they spend most of their time writing down their CV again and again, computing brownie points that they get from publication, number of pages they've published in the economic journal, the American Economic Review, citations, indices, formulae, this paraphernalia and regalia of quantification of qualities that has significantly diminished academic life the world over. In economics, this has been far worse than in any of the other sciences. And the reason for this is that in nature, in the natural sciences, I should say, the worth of one's, of a physicist or a chemist's theory is judged by a nature that doesn't give a damn about those theories. So if you're predicting the weather, if you're a meteorologist, it doesn't matter how good you are and what a reputation you have. The weather is out there, utterly impervious to your reputation, ready to pass very harsh judgment upon you if your model of the weather is not worth the candle. But imagine now for a moment that you are an economist with a great reputation for having predicted some financial crisis. Of course, this is a figment of my imagination here, because we economists have never predicted any financial crisis. Or we have predicted the last 90 financial crises out of the five that happened. So, but let's for a moment assume that there is some great economist, extremely prescient, with a mathematical model, with a computing device, with an econometric approach, which has allowed him or her to predict the 2008 collapse, say. And imagine that this person one night gets drunk and tweets to the rest of the world, tomorrow the stock exchange in London, in Frankfurt, and in the United States, in Wall Street, is going to collapse. I bet that there is a very strong chance that it will collapse, just because of the reputation of this person. Because unlike nature, society cares about our theories regarding society, especially the stock exchange. It's all about expectations. The equivalent in nature would be to live in a universe where the weather responds to our predictions about it. Imagine how hellish it would be to be a meteorologist in that case. Faced with this endogenous and irrepressible uncertainty caused by the fact that theories about society and about the economy are part of the facts that these theories need to explain. So there is this infinite regress between theory and reality. We should be humble about the limits of our analytical capacity. But we economists have never been humble about the limits of our analytical capacity. Those greats that I referred to were. Smith understood the limits of political economy. John Stuart Mill, even more so. They knew that they could not explain society on their own, that they needed philosophers, sociologists, historians, actually, that politics and qualitative subjects, Alfred Marshall said so in his textbook that everybody read in the first part of the 20th century, that we should beware as economists the dangers of trying to quantify qualities, because the result is that we diminish qualities and we end up with really terrible predictive quantities. But economists understood one thing, especially after the 1960s and 1970s, when I was growing up as an economist, and that is the power of monopoly. So increasingly we have created mathematical economic models which restate that which everybody understands in a language that nobody has any chance of understanding, thus creating a monopoly for our own discursive endeavors, and mathematizing everything so as to pretend that we are the physicists of society. Now, the problem with this is that economics can never be like physics for reasons that I have already outlined. Because of this interdependence between the phenomenon and the theory about the phenomenon, which is ubiquitous in social theory and in economic theory. So what did we do? As economists, we forced our models to yield
determinate solutions by torturing them. If you torture the data, if you torture the mathematics sufficiently, it will confess. In the end, of course, you end up with a beautiful piece of mathematics which actually has a solution, but which is completely and utterly useless. Now, why am I telling you this? I'm the finance minister of Greece. You are probably here to hear about the European Union. Well, the reason why Greece is imploding is because we created a monetary union based on particular economic models, which were produced in the way that I have just outlined. Now, it's one thing to produce an economic model because it's fun doing it, and you should have a lot of fun in university creating systems of axioms, theorems, and predictions, because this is a fantastic way, a marvelous way of sharpening your analytical skills. But you should always beware your artifacts. You should always remember of Mary Shelley and Frankenstein. Frankenstein was a very good man. The problem was that he created a beast, a thing that he could not control, for all the good intentions, to defeat death. We economists are a little bit like Dr. Frankenstein. We've created models with all the best intentions in the world, which in the end have stung back big time. The Eurozone was created on the basis of a particular model of how you bind together disparate currencies of disparate economies without taking a pause for a moment to consider the problems with that model. Let me give you, just briefly, if I may, the analytical critique of the model upon which the Eurozone was built. Now, I know that most of you are not economic students, and congratulations for that. And I'm not going to bore you to tears with some economic model, but I think I can capture the essence of the analytical error behind the Eurozone by means of a little parable, which you may have heard of, especially if you have suffered some class in philosophy, in analytical philosophy. It's called the... I will change the name for it. I will call it the Spanish Inquisition Dilemma. Imagine you are back in the Middle Ages, and we have a mathematician, a logician, somebody who spends day and night, possibly in Oxford, or maybe in some Catholic university, like the one I just visited in Coimbra in Portugal, an ancient university, in a Catholic place, Spanish Inquisition, who is captured by the Spanish Inquisition. He's being accused of heretical thinking. And the Inquisitor looks at him and says, "Your heresy is going to receive the harshest of punishments. You are going to burn, my dear sir. But because your crime is so dastardly of entertaining these mathematical thoughts against the order of the cosmos, your punishment is going to be even worse than just being burnt. So this is what we're going to do. Today is Monday, let's say. You're going to burn by the following Sunday. But you're not going to burn on a day when your mathematical logic tells you that you're going to burn with probability 100%. Take him away. He goes to his cell, he starts thinking. So I'm going to burn until next Monday. Which means, but I'm not going to burn on a day when I have good logical reasons to expect that I shall burn. So if I wait, if they don't burn me by, if I make it until next Sunday at midnight, there will only be one day left for them to burn me. So they will burn me on the Monday, which means they can't burn me on the Monday. Because I would know that they will burn me on the Monday, and therefore they cannot burn me on that day. Which means that if I survive until Saturday midnight, I will certainly be burned on Sunday, which means that they cannot burn on Sunday. Which means that if I survive until Friday midnight, given that we've just come to the conclusion, the logical conclusion, that Sunday and Monday are out, I must burn on Saturday, therefore I cannot burn on Saturday. Through backward induction, you come to the conclusion, he comes to the conclusion, I can't burn. I'm scot-free. I'll survive. This is the logic behind the equilibrium models that underpin the kind of mathematical economics that emerged and became dominant in the 1970s, and which underpinned, in turn, the design of a currency union like the euro. In other words, the profession, in a bid, the economics profession, in a bid to dominate the social sciences, in a bid to ensure that the economists got the lion's share of research funding in the universities, in a bid to portray ourselves as the serious social scientists, unlike the historians, the philosophers, the anthropologists, who are, you know, the riffraff. We created those models that effectively pretend to solve deep uncertainties mathematically. And then it was a matter of, if you want, technological prowess to transfer this kind of analysis onto economic models, which then politicians, who had their own reasons, this is another discussion, what the reasons of the politicians were, to bind together European countries under a single currency, utilized as the scientific veneer that justified and legitimized that which they were doing. There is a problem with this logic, however. Let's go back to our logician and to the Spanish Inquisitor, who was no intellectual dud. The logician knows that the Spanish Inquisitor is not dumb. So he thinks, hang on a second. If I was smart enough to work out that I can't burn, the Spanish Inquisitor is smart enough to know that I can't burn. So he will know that I will expect that there is a probability zero that I can burn on any day. So he can burn me on any day. When will he burn me? He can't burn me on the Monday. He can't burn me on the Sunday. He can't burn me. But if he can't burn me, then he can burn me. But if he can't burn me, then he can't burn me. So this is like a cat chasing its own tail. So what I'm saying is this. You can torture a particular modeling exercise to produce a determinate solution. But in reality, society is indeterminate. The idea that by creating the Eurozone according to rules that correspond to this equilibrium logic does not mean that society is going to behave in a way that complies with these rules. Let me begin my wrap-up, and I promise to answer all your questions concerning the nitty-gritty of the negotiations in which I was involved after this. This is just a warm-up. Allow me to begin to wrap up by means of three little stories. The year was 2011. I was flying on a Lufthansa flight from Frankfurt to New York, I believe. That was long before I became involved in politics. I was still an academic, engaged in this kind of modeling or criticizing these models. Next to me, there was this very pleasant chap. His name was Franz. He was German, and he was a banker, or actually a former banker. And we started talking about the crisis in Europe, about Greece, about all the things that you want me to talk about and which I'm refusing to. And he said to me, you know, from the moment the euro was instituted, my life, which had been perfectly pleasant before as a banker, turned into a nightmare. I said to him, Franz, why? He said, listen, up until 2000 was the year when the euro was instituted, I was the king of the universe. I would fly to Paris, I would fly to Athens, to your country, I would fly to Madrid, I would meet clients. The clients were corporates, they were bankers, local bankers, they were governments who wanted to borrow from my bank, a major bank, I won't mention its name. And they feted me. They took me to the nicest restaurants, they took me to the opera, they felt compelled to explain to me why they deserved a fat wad of money from my bank, then I would take their business plan, their proposals, their ideas, their track record back to Frankfurt. I would sit down and I would study it for about a week, and then I would make a recommendation to the board as to whether this particular loan should go through. Those were the good days. I said, what happened then? Then he said, after the euro was introduced, what happened was that headquarters ordered us to lend a particular sum of money every week, and if we failed to reach that quota, our jobs was on the line. So from being the master of the universe, suddenly I had to go to Madrid, to Athens, to Dublin, and to beg people to get money off my hands. Life wasn't worth living. At some point I had a stroke, and I resigned, he said to me. That's the first story. Second story. In 2010, the government of Greece went bankrupt. The Prime Minister of Greece, who is a friend of mine, at the time, he's still a friend, but the guy who was Prime Minister back then, George Papandreou, our friendship was very severely tested by the crisis and his handling of it, but that's another matter. At some point, the penny dropped. The state that he was prime minister of had gone bankrupt. And he went to Mrs. Merkel and to Mr. Sarkozy to give them the bad news. We're bankrupt. Pause. Let's go back to 2008. Do you remember the CEO of Lehman Brothers, Mr. Fowles? Yeah. Do you remember the story that he went to the US Treasury to talk to Hank Paulson, the treasurer of the United States of America, to give him similar news? We're bankrupt and we need a bailout. At that point, Hank Paulson said to him, you're not getting it. Go bankrupt. End the pause. Go back to Papandreou with Merkel and Sarkozy. He tells them exactly the same thing that the CEO of Lehman Brothers said to the American authorities. We are bankrupt. He received the most astonishing answer in the annals of human history. The 999, as I call it, or 9 cubed. You are not allowed to go bankrupt. You are getting no loan from us, and there will be no interest rate relief. Imagine if Hank Paulson had said that to the Lehman Brothers CEO. I'm not giving you a bailout, and you're not allowed to go bankrupt. He would have looked at them like a dog, startled by the illogicality of the sentence that was uttered. For 6-7 months, Europe lived that gross denial. Now, of course, that couldn't last for long, because if you're bankrupt, either you are bailed out or you just shut down your operations. There is no other alternative. So in May of 2010, Europe responded in its infinite wisdom to the bankruptcy of Greece as follows. They gave the largest loan in human history in absolute terms, in pound terms, in dollar terms, in euro terms, to the most insolvent state on condition of a degree of austerity that with mathematical precision would crash the national income from which the old loans that were unpayable and the new gargantuan loans would have to be repaid. You need to be about 8, 9, 10 years old to understand that this cannot end well. And the reason why I'm the former, why I became finance minister, representing a party whose name is the Radical Left Alliance of Greece, Syriza, is precisely because the whole thing went pear-shaped. And our little left-wing party was catapulted from 4% to 40%. And I was the finance minister whose job it was to go back to the center of Europe, to Brussels, to Frankfurt, to Berlin, and to argue the case for a smidgen of rationality, which was denied us. On the 25th of June, last June,
I was presented with an ultimatum in the Eurogroup. I looked at it. It contained a fiscal plan for Greece, a funding plan for Greece, and a set of reforms. I looked at it with the eyes of an economist, and I concluded that this is a plan that it is impossible to implement without falling deeper into the black hole. In other words, if I signed it, it would be in bad faith towards my European fellow citizens, because I would be taking another large sum of money from them under conditions which I knew would guarantee that I would not be able to repay them. And I didn't feel that I had the moral authority to do this, especially to extend the crisis into the future, pretending that it was solved while making it larger. My Prime Minister, myself, the members of the Inner Cabinet on that day decided that we do not want to confront Europe, official Europe. We don't want to say no to them and cause a clash, but at the same time, we didn't have the moral, political, intellectual right, not authority, right, to sign on the dotted line of this non-viable agreement. By the way, before we made this decision, I had asked quite significant people in the International Monetary Fund, in the European Central Bank, as well as a gentleman whose name you may have heard of, Wolfgang Schäuble, whether they thought that this was viable. And they all said to me that they agreed with me that it isn't. So this is another pivotal moment in human history. It's the first time in human history a creditor or creditors are demanding of debtors that the debtors shall accept another large sum of money under conditions that guarantee that the creditors will not get their money back. Wrap your mind around that one. At that point, we decided we are going to put this to the Greek people. We're going to say to them, this is what Europe has come up with in the form of an ultimatum. They tell us that if we don't accept it, our banks will be closed forever, and Armageddon will hit us. We don't believe that this is the case. We are asking you to empower us to go back for more negotiations. Vote no. But if you vote yes, because we are bona fide Democrats, we're going to respect your yes vote, and somehow we will contrive to ensure that this toxic agreement is signed and implemented to the extent that it can be, or we will pretend to be implementing it, or we will allow others who believe in it to come and implement it. This is what Democrats should do. In the Eurogroup meeting, when I announced that we are putting this matter to the people of Greece to decide in a referendum whether they accept the ultimatum that the Eurogroup was giving me or not, it was astonishing. The number of ministers of finance, and some of those people, some of the minority of ministers of finance, for whom I held in high esteem, the minority, they turned around and they said to me, Yanis, are you serious? You're putting to the people in a referendum such a complicated issue? And I thought, oh my God, and I'm an atheist. They are just challenging the principle of democracy. What's democracy? As Winston Churchill said, it's a terrible system, but it's the best of all alternatives. It's a system where every person, whether they're rich, poor, stupid, intelligent, educated, completely literate, gets one vote to make decisions of grave importance for the future of a nation. That's what democracy is. Not in the Eurogroup. Democracy in the Eurogroup is a readiness to simply toe the line. A line that is debated and discussed behind closed doors by shady characters that European citizens never elected, never have even heard of. I'm very much looking forward to the discussion, because in precisely the same way that the paradox involving the logician and the Spanish inquisitor is based on a contradiction, my message with which I want to close this part of tonight's proceedings is that we must not try to avoid contradictions.
We must understand when reality is contradictory, and we must embrace the contradiction in a creative way, which is going to speak truth to power and will serve the interests of truth only to the extent that we come to these problems with the open-mindedness that great universities like this one impart upon privileged people like you. The contradiction that I want to leave you with is, if you want, also a recommendation regarding the forthcoming referendum here. And it is a view that is utterly consistent with my approach to Europe at the moment. I believe that there is not one person, at least in this room, who is more scathing and critical of Brussels than I am. I have experienced it to my bone. I can tell you that the way that Brussels operates as a democracy-free zone, as an authoritarian haven for a combination of irrationality and unfreedom. Nevertheless, I am the same person who stands here in front of you saying, no retreat from the European Union. We need to stay in it and fight the Brussels combination of autocracy, unfreedom, irrationality, and fight them with the determination and the anti-establishment energy that only an academic approach to life and to government can impart upon citizens. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor. I'd like to pick up on that theme that you finished on, this notion of re-injecting democracy into Brussels. And while you've repeatedly said that rolling back Europe to nation states is no longer possible, do you think the EU is capable of reform, or is the thing you're fighting for while staying within the EU a completely new sort of system?
The extent to which the European Union is capable of reform depends on us. That has always been the case in politics. The extent to which, for instance, the Magna Carta was possible depended on the capacity of the barons and the lords to bind together and demand that the Magna Carta ought to be passed from the king. The reason why we have the universal franchise at the moment and no slavery is because several extremely courageous people in centuries past banded together against all odds and against the pessimistic expectations of the vast majority of people in this country and elsewhere to fight for it. Brussels is not going to reform itself. Brussels is a malignant technocracy that is technically very incompetent too, that is only interested in multiplying the number of subjects under its authority and replicating its incompetence. So if you leave them alone, either we as Greeks or Germans or French, or you by retreating, of course there is no chance of reform. But if we all band together and demand sensible, rational, liberal reforms, there's nothing they can do to stop us.
I'm curious about the part that you will play in this movement and the nature of your own political identity. You've referred to yourself with a number of different political labels, a libertarian Marxist, an erratic Marxist. Do you think that using such a label, including specifically the word Marxist, makes people take you less seriously?
Why are you focusing on the Marxist, not on libertarian? People do that all the time. I call myself a libertarian Marxist as part of my embracing of contradictions. And, you know, it's like, you remember Schumpeter was talking about creative destruction. But people didn't say to them, why are you in favor of destruction? The meaning of the term that Schumpeter came up with, by which to support capitalism and competition, even in the presence of oligopolies, you see, I can't stop myself being an economist. Schumpeter's great contribution to our understanding of the world we live in came through putting these two words together, creative and destruction. This is what I'm trying to do. Marx was absolutely essential in my understanding of the world for a number of reasons, which I won't bore you with. I'll just mention one. Have you noticed a delicious contradiction and a disturbing contradiction in our world over the last 100, 200 years? And that is that we live in a system that produces immense wealth, technological innovations, gadgets, iPhones, you know, all that stuff. And the same system produces the worst kind of poverty that humanity has ever experienced. The worst kind of inequality, and also periodic calamitous economic crisis that jeopardize the living standards, indeed throws away whole communities and generations into the dustbin of history. This is not an accident. If you start thinking of it from a Marxist perspective, that crisis is an essential regulatory part of capitalism, then you get an idea of the real difficulties that governments have. If you don't have this perspective and you have this equilibrium approach that I was castigating before by means of my metaphor using the Spanish Inquisition, if you have this view, then all the ills in the world are due to government. The crisis of 2008 is because the government got it wrong. Well, the government gets it wrong most of the time, there's no doubt about that. But Marx's position, Marx's contribution, was to show analytically that even if God and her angels were to descend upon, you see, her, because the gender balance in this union is not very good. Even if God and her angels were to descend upon us and run the government, crisis would still happen because they are part of the system. So that's where I believe the contribution of Marx is. The libertarian contribution comes from a deep sense of guilt that I carry with me as a left-winger. Because we left-wingers began with a humanist agenda for emancipating the working classes, for emancipating the capitalists from the need constantly to accumulate capital, and we ended up producing the gulag. So we left-wingers have constantly to be critical of our own past and constantly to keep checks and balances on ourselves because we have this tendency towards creating Stalinism. The other side of politics, the libertarian side of politics, has exactly the same problem. Don't forget that the greatest libertarian economists from the School of Chicago were the greatest supporter of that beast called Pinochet. So this embracement of our contradictions is essential in order to steer a middle course and to remain true to humanitarianism.
Final question from me before we open to the floor, a retrospective question on the last 12 months. Do you think that your political career has been a failure?
Oh, my goodness. Well, judging by the number of people who want to talk to me, either I am a heroic failure that illuminates parts of people's dark side, or alternatively, and this is my view, the state of Europe is pretty depressing and pretty dire. A small country like Greece, producing a government like ours, could not possibly hope to change Europe in a few short months through the strategies and negotiating skills of one man or two people or five people or, you know, a band of 10 politicians coming from Athens. What we did was to light a small candle instead of cursing the darkness. And I believe that that small candle, even though it was extinguished on the 13th of July by a ruthless troika, nevertheless created sufficient illumination in Europe to start Europeans, not necessarily left-wingers, Democrats, who are now beginning to see that which I and others, operating as whistleblowers, communicate to Europeans, that there is a dearth of democracy and a dearth of rationality in the center of Europe. I would like to hope that we started something that will win us the war, even though this battle was lost.
An excellent political answer. We're going to open it up to the floor now. Could you please make sure that you speak into the microphone that's going to be passed around the chamber? Can I start with the lady on the aisle in the middle, halfway down? Yes, you, madam.
Thanks a lot for that great talk. I wanted to ask a question. What would your advice be when you find yourself in a discussion in a room with people who all disagree with you and might not take your view serious at all? How do you keep your mental strength to stand by your point of view and continue arguing your case?
Well, this is what university life teaches one. Huh? What university life ought to teach all of us is to be guided by two things. Firstly, an inability to be impressed by authority or by what the majority thinks. Because if we were constantly impressed by authority, then we would still believe that the Earth is the center of the universe. Yeah? So, subverting the dominant paradigm is one principle. The second principle is to believe in the power of reason, that if you manage to articulate your arguments well, eventually they will win over, as long as they are sound. And maybe I should add a third element to this, to be constantly self-deprecating and constantly self-critical. Because there's nothing worse than people who are mightily impressed by the sound of their voices.
Thank you. Thank you for your talk, Mr. Varoufakis. And I have to say, content-wise, I sympathize with you very much. But I read the reconstruction of The Guardian last week, which I'm sure you've read as well. I'd like to confront you with a few quotes, two very brief ones. The first one is, Varoufakis had done nothing but exasperate his fellow finance ministers.
It's true.
And second of all... And second of all, this is an anonymous EU official. They started seeing us as human beings and not as robots. It made things so much easier. So as much as you may...
You mean after I left?
Sorry? After, yes, the second your quotation successor, say, sorry. Yes, that was
just,
successor.
Just for the benefit of the audience.
Yes.
The second quotation is that after I left, my successor started looking at them as human beings and not robots.
Yes, indeed. Yeah. So as much as you may be right on the content... everyone seemed to hate you there. Nobody.
Do you want me to comment on these two then, and then you continue? So that let me comment on those two quotations, then you can continue and ask your question. But on the first question, on the first point you made, or that the Guardian made, or some people in the Eurogroup made, that I exasperate them, it is absolutely true. Because I continue to insist that we should talk about macroeconomic problems in a macroeconomic fashion. So when I presented to them our policy proposals in juxtaposition to the program that had failed, a program that had produced a reduction in national income by 28% and an increase in unemployment by 20%, can only be described as a failure. Imagine if unemployment were to rise by 20% in this country and you lost a quarter of your income. Who would ever say anything other than this was a failed policy? Yeah? So I insisted on saying this. And I insisted on trying to find a macroeconomic narrative that made sense in order to produce a new program. And all, you know, the answer I got, do you know what the answer I would get was? Firstly, Yanis, you are insisting on discussing the rules. The rules are the rules. And I would say, yes, but why are the rules? The rules are, we create rules as instruments to help us deliver policies that work to our people, okay? The rules are not divinely determined. In this Eurogroup, we created them. So this Eurogroup, you know, a company, corporation, revises its modus operandi all the time. If it doesn't, it dies. So I exasperated them because I kept insisting that I'm not going to sign an agreement, which made no sense, and I was never going to get more money from their taxpayers when I thought I could not repay it. And that exasperated them. And I'm very glad. Very glad. On the second point, my successor, to whom they are referring, is a man called Euclid Tsakalotos. He's a good friend. He's a product of this place. His PhD is from Oxford. I can assure you that there was complete continuity between what I did and what he did. Indeed, Euclid and I went everywhere together. When I visited as finance minister George Osborne at 11 Downing Street, Euclid was with me. When I went to the Eurogroup, Euclid was with me. I can assure you that my views were his views. Do you know what the difference was after I left and Euclid took over? The difference was that our government surrendered to the toxic third bailout. Had I surrendered, they would have loved me too. The reason why they didn't like me was because I refused to surrender.
The next question, I think.
I gave him the opportunity to answer a question. Yeah.
Because I interrupted him.
Because your answer might be symptomatic of what your Minister of Finance colleagues perceived as the problem, which is that content-wise, you may or may not be right, but everyone just seems to hate you. No,
that's not true. Don't overdo it. Look.
Excuse me, sir. When the Dutch television interviewed Jeroen Dijsselbloem a few months ago, and I asked you for comments about him, your answer was, "No, I don't want to comment because Jeroen Dijsselbloem doesn't deserve the last words." That's what you told the makers of the program. So, isn't the reason that you lost the battle, the battle that was so important, isn't it not because it was totally impossible, but also because of the way you personally interacted with everyone, made only enemies, and that was the reason that in the end they just weren't able and willing to listen to you? Wasn't that one of the huge problems?
Well, the answer to this very question is very simple. No. I had very good relationships. I had a very good relationship personally with all of them, especially with Wolfgang Schäuble. With Dijsselbloem, I didn't have a relationship, either positive or negative. He confirms this. What happened on that occasion when I said no to being interviewed? There was going to be a meeting like this in some university in Holland, and I was invited to go along and have a debate with Jeroen, which I, of course, very happy to do. Very happy to do. But I couldn't go there that day because I had a prior commitment. So I told them I can't do this. And then they said, will you record something that we will play and then he can comment on that? And I said, no, because this is not a dialogue. It's one thing to say that we are in the same space and we have a genuine exchange. It's quite another for me to be canned in a video, which then he will be commenting upon without my having an opportunity to answer. And I don't think that that infuriates anyone. It's what any sensible person in my position would have said.
Hi. You went on Question Time, it was probably about 6 weeks ago, and there was a bloke in the audience and he tried to start a parable about having £10 at the end of the week and going to the pub and buying 4 pints. Mm-hmm. And you explained to him correctly that his, you know, personal life wasn't a very good model for economics. But his personal life has been used as a model for economics by, that's particularly exactly in this country, by the Conservative Party. And I just wanted to ask why you thought the centre-left and the left in this country and in Europe has failed so spectacularly, really, to debug that myth?
Well, thank you for this question. It's true. It's the short answer to your question is because the left has lost its mojo some time ago. We have, especially the Labour left in this country, the Social Democrats in my country, in France, in Germany, for some reason, which is the topic of another lecture, lost their anti-establishment critical capacity or energy, since I was referring to an anti-establishment energy. They were far more interested in being admitted into the corridors of power and into polite society than in changing the world. George Bernard Shaw once said that he was being ironic, that the reasonable people adapt themselves to the world. Well, the left was meant to be unreasonable, trying to adapt the world to its views of what the world ought to be like. And the left lost that. So Tony Blair was much more interested in being considered a good conservative boy than changing Britain, or changing it in a way that is consistent with the Labour Party. But on the question of this gentleman, okay, he sounded a bit crass, but you're right. The main point he was making is one which is dominant around the world to this day. It's dominant in the Republican Party in the United States. It's dominant even in the socialist parties of Europe. The idea of belt tightening, of austerity. Now, let me make one thing abundantly clear here. I believe in austerity. Is it startling? I do believe in austerity at a personal level, at the level of a family, at the level of a shop, at the level of a company. So when your income shrinks and suddenly you're in the red and you can't make ends meet, you've got to tighten your belt. If you don't tighten your belt, you will go bankrupt. So prudence should guide you towards austerity at a personal level. But the point that you raised and I raised and we ought to raise all the time, and George Osborne understands it. It's not that he doesn't understand. That's why I've defended him in a way that maybe he doesn't like, but nevertheless I defended him. The point is that the reason why austerity works, belt tightening works at the personal level, is because there is a strict independence between your outflows and your inflows, your income and your expenditure. So if tonight you don't have a pint, you abstain from having a pint. How much is a pint these days? £4. Okay, let's say £4. You've saved £4. Your income, the amount of money you have in your pocket, doesn't shrink, doesn't increase, stays the same. You just have £4 more, right? But at the level of a macroeconomy, that's why I kept talking macroeconomics in the Eurogroup, and I was being blamed for insisting of talking economics in the Eurogroup. You know, the mind boggles. At the macroeconomic level, in an economy, take Britain. In an economy like Britain, total expenditure equals total income. So my expenditure is your income if I'm buying something from you. So our total expenditure equals our total income. So suddenly there is a complete breakdown in the independence between expenditure and income. So what happens during a crisis is this. It happened in 2008 with the credit crunch, with the implosion of Wall Street, the City of London, and so on. People start fearing, they cut down on spending, debt becomes unsustainable if the debt bubble implodes and all that. What happens is corporations and households, seeing that now they are in trouble, they stop spending. They deleverage, in the language of the financial press. So the private sector as a whole, families, individuals, companies, spend less on investment, on expenditure, on cars, on aeroplanes, on everything. Yeah, they spend. So there is a shrinkage of private expenditure. If the state, which now suddenly suffers a widening budget deficit, why? Because as private expenditure shrinks, the tax take of the government comes down. At the very same time, usually there is an increase in unemployment, so unemployment benefits are more costly for the government, so the government's expenditure goes up during a crisis, and its tax take comes down. So the budget rises. So if suddenly you panic and you try to apply the principles of austerity that work at the private level, you try to apply this at the governmental, macroeconomic level, what happens is, while private expenditure shrinks, public expenditure shrinks. What's the sum of these two, private and public expenditure? It's total income. So total income is going to shrink faster if at the macroeconomic level the government goes austerian. This is why austerity doesn't work. George Osborne knows that, because he tried a little bit of austerity when he was elected, and the nascent recovery that he inherited from the last months of Brown went down, and he stopped doing it.
Thank you. Thank you for your interesting speech. You're making a great show for all of this.
That's why they invited me.
Yeah, sure. I would like to ask about the situation in Greece and about the Greek people. I mean, you were anyways the finance minister of Greek in a time that was very difficult for the country, and you stepped down voluntarily, and the nation was left in very, very difficult situation. So what do you think about your half-year era as finance minister yourself? And do you regret about the decisions you made or did not make? And can you sleep at night?
Oh, very well, very well, very well. Because I resigned at that particular point in time, my conscience is clear. And that's why I can sleep at night. But let me be clear on the essence of your question. Look, the only reason why I entered the political sphere, I never wanted to. By the way, I believe that politicians should be like academics. Academics that want to be deans and heads of department should be disqualified from the job because it means they're not good academics. Why do you want to be a manager when you're an academic? Similarly, any politician who really loves being a politician or a minister who wants to be minister should be disqualified. They're dangerous people. So we should have reluctant heads of department and a reluctant politician. So I can assure you I was a reluctant politician. The only reason why I threw my hat in the political ring was this. Europe began disintegrating after our generation's 1929, which occurred in 2008. We had a flimsy monetary architecture, which was never going to survive a financial credit crunch like the one we had. It was too flimsy. And of course, when an edifice starts fragmenting, it starts fragmenting from the flimsiest part of the edifice, and that was Greece. So Greece is not important, except to the Greeks, except for the reason that it is, if you want, it accentuates the problem with Europe. If Greece was not part of the European Monetary Union in 2000, we would still have the same crisis in the European Monetary Union, but Greece would not be part of the conversation now. But because Greece was the first domino to fall during the domino effect, it's the one that suffers the most. It's the one where Europe tested and tried out terrible policies before transferring them to Ireland, Portugal, Spain. Of course, even Brussels learned some lessons. So the program that was imposed on Portugal was much milder compared to Greece. This is why Portugal did not collapse the way that Greece did. My purpose for entering politics, given that I knew I was going to be the Minister of Finance of Greece, was to go to the Eurogroup and say to them, okay, we are all to blame. We Greeks, for having sustained an unsustainable level of debt before the crisis, you for having no plan of how to address a major financial crisis if it happened. Let's sit down and work out rationally a way of ameliorating the crisis in Greece, and then try to imagine ways in which the lessons from that can be transferred to the rest of the monetary union. But as I said before, that infuriated my colleagues because they were simply not interested in having that conversation. I can tell you why, but that's another story. My one promise to my electorate, to the people that voted for me, the one promise I had made was that I was going to remain steadfast in my commitment not to sign another loan until and unless the policies and the conditions, the conditionalities of that loan, allowed a significant probability, not a huge probability, but a significant probability that this would lead us to recovery and to a capacity to repay our German, Slovak, Italian friends for lending us the new money. The ultimatum, I mentioned that before in my talk, that was given to me on the 25th of June, I think that we can sit down with anyone who is who brings good faith to the discussion, and I can prove to them as a mathematical theorem that that ultimatum, that agreement that was proposed to us, was simply not viable. And as I said, Dr. Wolfgang Schäuble said this to me. The good people of the International Monetary Fund agreed with me. So we have... And when my prime minister and my government, on the 5th of July, after the courageous Greek people voted no to this toxic deal, when my government decided to surrender, I was the finance minister, which meant that I would have to sign personally. The only person who signs this loan agreement is the finance minister. In other words, I would have to violate the single promise I gave to my electorate as well as to European peoples, European citizens. And I was not prepared to do that. And I did what I think anyone in my position ought to have done. I resigned. That's why I sleep at night.
Thank you very much. You're not only an economist, but you've also written extensively on the subject of game theory. And I imagine that in the negotiations in the Eurogroup, you used the knowledge that you gained from that. But to an outsider, when looking at your behavior in the Eurogroup itself, it seemed more as though your strategy, your broad strategy, was something like, you're either going to help us, or we're going to commit suicide. How is this going to achieve anything, and how can this come from someone who is a professor in game theory?
Thank you for your question. Let me just say something about game theory. As a professor, I was fascinated by game theory. But in the way that one is fascinated by chess. If you try to apply the rules of chess or the insights you get from chess in the battlefield, you're a very bad general. I always warned my students, long before I was involved in politics, that game theory is fantastic. It's absolutely splendid as a tool by which to test the limits of analytical reasoning. But it is an awful contraption for helping you answer the question, okay, when I'm involved in a negotiation, what should I do? I wrote an article in the New York Times immediately after I became finance minister in which I said no time for games, in which I explained why game theory was utterly detrimental as a guide to somebody like me, detrimental to the interests of participants. So I just wanted to make this clear. For me, game theory is not something that I used, since I always advised my students not to see it as a source of practical advice. I'm trying to be consistent. The question that you're asking effectively was, what was our outside option? What was our credible threat? Because if our credible threat was that we would commit suicide, then it wasn't a credible threat. It's like when my daughter says to me, I have a 12-year-old daughter, sometimes, you know, laughingly she says, Dad, if you don't do this... Oh, actually, no, she doesn't. I say this to her. I forgot who the adult is. She is the adult. I say to her, if you don't do your homework, I'll hold my breath until I die. She says, yeah, right, okay. Now, that's not a credible threat, yeah? So if the credible threat was that we would commit suicide, if you're right in your assessment of what my credible threat or my threat was, then it was not credible. But I do believe that it was credible. Many journalists have infected the mind of the public with a view that I was in the business of threatening my colleagues with Grexit, with retaliation, with things that would be catastrophic for our country. It's not true. What I said to them was very, very simple. I said to them, we are prepared to compromise on everything except the viability of the agreement that we will reach with you. This is along the lines of what I was saying before. And they kept insisting on a non-viable program, which they knew it was non-viable. If you want, we can discuss why. But this is the situation. What was the threat with which we could shift their position? It was threefold. Firstly, if they were to close down our banking system, which they did on the 30th of June, my recommendation to my cabinet was that we should immediately haircut 27 billion euros worth of debt that we had towards the Central Bank of Europe. If you close down our banks, we have every right, every moral right, and indeed we had a moral and political duty to say to you, well, in that case, the debt we owe you is not going to be repaid this year, it will be repaid in 2042, let's say. Huh? So that's one response. Secondly, to create a parallel euro-denominated payment system. I've written an article in the Financial Times, I can direct you to it, that would allow us to breathe, with some difficulty, but breathe nevertheless, to conduct business, even with banks that were closed. And there's a third part which is more legalistic, I'm not going to mention that. That was, so if you asked me back then, if they push you very fiercely, as they did, towards signing a non-viable agreement, the agreement that you promised to your electorate that you will never sign, and they shut down your banking system in order to force you to do it, what would you do? This is the answer. That's not committing suicide. I believe that had to haircut those bonds, the ECB would be in dire straits. Not because of the sum being significant, but because it would expose the Central Bank of Europe to massive legal action by the Central Bank of Germany on the issue of quantitative easing, which is what keeps the Eurozone together. Why were these measures used in order to bolster our position? This is something that you can't ask me, because it was a decision by my cabinet, inner cabinet, and the Greek prime minister, a decision that I opposed, and the result is that I'm the ex-finance minister.
Thank you. Thank you for a very interesting talk. I was also interested to hear about the kind of submission to or lack of creativity in the face of economic or orthodoxy that has that you were talking about in the beginning. And I was wondering, and I was curious to hear what do you think are the reasons for the, and what are the structural determinants maybe that make people or make in society that prevents that creativity to be discussed, both politically, maybe perhaps most interestingly, if you only then talk about politics. For example, in Brussels, when if people are aware that this is a non-viable plan, or if George Osborne knows that this is that austerity is probably not a good way to stimulate economic growth, what do you think are the reasons for the lack of creativity, or if it's at the individual level, or if there's something else going on that might be rooted in academia, what do you think are the reasons for that impasse?
Look, human nature is driven by two opposing impulses. One impulse is to conform. We don't like to stick out. We feel insecure when we stick out. We have that impulse, the sheep strategy. But there is another impulse too, the subversive strategy. You know, the Monty Python one. You're all individuals. I'm not. That kind of thing, right? We have that. That's the beauty of the human condition. That we have a tendency to conform and a tendency to subvert. In a sense, in biological terms, it's like if you want the replicator dynamic, which produces conformity, it reproduces patterns that exist, and then you have mutations that are subversive. And some of these mutations can change the world, it can create a new species in biology, a new kind of society. Democracy was the result of a mutation. Somebody said, no, I'm not taking this anymore. Huh? Or some people saying that and creating a kind of revolution that brings about a transformation in society. The interesting question is, why have mutations become far more subdued in the last 30 years? And why has there been a lot more conformity? In the economics profession, you see a lot more of this. I am very much afraid, I know that I'm going to enrage my colleagues in saying this, the departments of economics around the world are producing inanity in droves, and they are producing very little insightful, new, subversive thinking. And what concerns me was that, for instance, is that we had a major economic crisis in the 1930s. It produced amazing thinkers. thinkers that still influence us, from the left and the right. John Maynard Keynes' general theory, part of which I try to outline here by making this distinction between micro and macro, is one example. Schumpeter, whom I mentioned before, is another example, more on the free market side, if you want. What has been produced after 2008? Nothing. Zero. Brain deadness, death throughout the economics departments. There are some very good economists who do some good work and say interesting things in spite of the state of the profession, not because of it. So this is a very interesting question, but it's a historical question. And I think it has to do with the way financialization has depleted important values. And I don't believe this is a left-right thing, because financialization has undermined not only labor, but also capital. So if you're an industrialist, if you produce stuff, material things, your life is extremely difficult in a world where value is created in industry, but it's increasingly shifting to the financial sector. And the financial sector is, through its dividing and multiplying, through its triumphant march, spreading a kind of mentality in the universities, in the departments, that is detrimental to subversive thinking and to critical thinking.
As a libertarian Marxist, I'm wondering what your position on like a minimum basic income is, maybe for Greece to replace the welfare state, but perhaps even all over the world.
Well, I'm all for it. I believe that a civilized society, or the degree to which a society civilizes, is to be judged by how well it looks after its weakest members, independently of whether they're deserving or not. In a family, if you have an undeserving younger brother or sister, you still have, I think, if you're a decent person, to make sure that they have food to eat and shelter. And if they get sick, that you look after them, even if they're scoundrels. Eh? And I believe that society should be doing the same. The problem is, of course, how do you create the institutions and the incentives in the social order in which we live that will allow society to do this without jeopardizing the dynamism of those who are not scoundrels and who don't want to sit around doing nothing? That is the issue. Regarding Greece, we are so far away from talking about the basic income. In Greece today, there are children that faint at school because of malnutrition. And teachers whose salary has been cut by half, who rush out to the shop to buy some milk to feed them. We are a failed state as a result of being part of a monetary union, which, as I said before, was never designed to take the financial crisis that started in 2008, and which remains in denial of the need to do something substantial to bolster its architecture.
To finish, I'm a little bit confused by one of the analogies used earlier on, your story about the Spanish Inquisition. So just to clarify, does the logician burn or not?
It's utterly indeterminate, and that's the beauty of this story, that the Spanish Inquisitor gave a set of rules which it is impossible to implement.
Exactly.
A bit like the Eurozones.
Professor Varoufakis has been incredibly gracious and agreed actually to come to the bar after this talk to speak with the students. So please do come to the bar if you'd like to ask further questions of Professor Varoufakis. Would you please join me in thanking Yanis Varoufakis.